don't know what.
It's always a challenge following Glenn, because I sit up the back and listen to them, and got my hand up for the Labrador bit. And I've got a wife who actually confesses that she ate a whole packet of Tim Tams because she was studying for a final university exam. She got halfway through and she thought, oh, it's one more. And she got three quarters of the way through and she thought she had to destroy the evidence, but she ate the rest of it. Got rid of the packet. So, you know, when Glenn talks about eating Tim Tams, take my wife as an example that she can actually eat a whole packet. What I'm going to share with you today is a few things around exercise. And Glenn touched on the fact that exercise is the other part of the equation. But I'm going to share with you at the start why exercise is a really difficult way to lose weight. I'll then go on and talk about why it's such an important part of maintaining your weight, and some of the myths and some of the stories around exercise that confuse people and have a lot of people doing the wrong things and wasting their time. As Jilly said, my aim is really for you to be able to go out of here with an idea of, okay, if it's something I have to do, then how do I get the best return on my time and effort? Because let's face it, we don't want to spend all our time and effort exercising and eating carrot sticks just to enjoy life, because that is life, right? So we want to spend as little time as possible staying healthy so we can enjoy all the things that we want to do. But exercise in itself is a difficult way to lose weight. And there's a few reasons for that. One of the first reasons, or the main reason, is it takes a lot of exercise to burn up calories. Now, there's about 160 calories in a can of Coke. And in the old scale of miles, can you not understand what a difference when I say what a mile is? For those who are under 25, so a mile is 1.6 kilometres. I have had to explain that to people, but the calculation works better in miles. But we burn up on average about 100 calories for every mile that we cover. We're walking, we're running, on foot, not in your car or on a motorbike. Yeah. So on foot, for every mile that we cover, we burn about 100 calories. So, I don't know about you, but every time you drink a can of Coke, how many people think, oh, I've got to walk a mile and a half just to burn that off? And how many people would have walked enough distance in their life to burn up all the calories in Coke they've had over the years? I know I probably haven't. You actually need to burn, you actually need to do a lot of exercise to burn all the calories. Now, there's about 8,000 calories in a kilogram of body fat. And if we're walking at about 10 kilometres an hour, sort of 6 miles an hour, we're burning about 10 calories a minute. Yeah? So if we need to burn up 1 kilogram of body fat, that's about 800 minutes of exercise that we need to do. Anyone done the sums on 800 minutes? Yeah, it's about 13 hours, isn't it? Yeah. If you want to burn a kilogram of body fat, you just need to go for a walk for 13 hours. Yeah. Doesn't sound very enjoyable. So when you do the sums on how much exercise you have to do to burn that specific amount of fat, it's hard work. Yeah. Now, that's one reason why exercise is a hard way to lose weight. Yeah? But it's really important for us to maintain it. Another reason that exercise is a hard way for us to lose weight is that it takes a long time. You know, I just said 13 hours, but it takes a long time for our body to adapt. So when we exercise, effectively what we're doing is we're putting our body under stress. And when our body gets under stress, what it does is it's a fantastic ability to adapt to the stresses that are placed on it. But that doesn't happen overnight. So we kind of have to stick at it for long enough for those changes to happen. But what happens for most people when they decide they want to lose weight and they're going to reduce their food intake and they're going to exercise more, is they kind of expect it to happen really quickly. So how many people have gone on a diet or seen a diet advertised that's promised 3 months, that you'll get results in 3 months? Yeah, they do, don't they? It's like Glenn said, that's how they get you to sign up. But the reality is around exercise, it's going to take quite a while for the changes to happen on the inside before you're going to start to see any changes on the outside. Is there anybody here, apart from females who are pregnant, who put on a lot of weight in 3 months? A few. Yeah? Mostly, it kind of creeps on over the years, doesn't it? You know, it's a kilo here and a kilo there and 500 grams, and next minute we're 45 and we've got 25 kilos extra. But when we go on a diet, we kind of want it to fall off like that. Well, the body just doesn't work that way, so the body has to take time for all these changes to happen inside the muscles, inside the cells, for you then to be able to become more efficient at burning fats and reducing your weight. So people often give up. So using just exercise alone is a tough way to lose weight because it just takes so long. And the third reason that exercise is a difficult way to lose weight is if you're doing it properly, what are the things that are going to happen? Well, your muscles are going to get a bit stronger, so they're going to get a bit denser. Hopefully your bones are going to get stronger, so they're going to be a bit denser. Your blood volume might go up, so you're going to have more fluid in there. You'll probably put more glycogen in the muscles, and you store more glycogen, you store more fluid. All of those things added up, then you're actually going to put on weight. So if you're using scales as your only measure as to how effective my exercise program is going to help me lose weight, and you look down there and think, put on 500 grams, well, you kind of hope you put on some good weight by exercising. So people often look at the scales and think, this isn't working, and give up. But the reality is it is working, they're just using the wrong measure to assess how successful it's been. So having said that, they're all the reasons why exercise is a really tough way to lose weight. But that doesn't mean we shouldn't be doing it, because to maintain our weight over the long term and for health, it's essential. It's really important that we keep doing it, because it's probably the most important thing. When I talked the little story about, you know, the only way to live a long life is not to die young, I spent 12 years working in the aged care industry, and it was quite clear to me working there that the people who maintain their activity levels maintain a reasonable level of fitness, the ones who enjoyed healthier lives as they got older. And the older we get, the more important it becomes. So how does exercise help us? Because now I've just convinced you that, well, it's a waste of time to lose weight. Now I'm going to try and convince you that you still need to do it, even though it might not be so helpful in losing the weight. There's a few reasons. There's a number of reasons. One of the things that people think is, gosh, if I exercise, I'm just going to get hungry, I'm just going to eat more. So don't exercise because you just eat more. In fact, I've seen some advertisements for weight loss programs that have said you won't have to exercise because that just makes you hungrier anyway, so why would you do it? Has anyone read one of those? Yeah. The reality is, when they've looked at the research, they've actually found that people who are active actually control their eating better than people who are significantly overweight. So there's something about being active, and whether it's the metabolism in the cells, I don't know the exact mechanism, but some of the enzymes and some of the hormones in the body that control our hunger are actually better controlled when we exercise and when we're active. It seems to be that excess body fat actually disrupts those normal signals that we get in the body about stopping us from overeating. So one way it helps is to change our appetite. Who are the emotional eaters? Yeah, kind of get stressed and, yeah. Yeah, that's right. I mean, Cadbury's make the best antidepressants in the world. Yeah. So if we can control our moods better, yeah, we're more likely to eat better foods, because we tend to make poor choices when we're stressed and depressed and anxious. So if there's mechanisms that will help us to control our moods, we're going to eat better. And we know that exercise is one of the factors that helps to control how we feel. So if it helps, what it does is it helps the body to produce a substance called serotonin, which is like our natural happy drug. Yeah. And the more of that we've got, the less that we'll crave foods like carbohydrates and chocolates. And the more that we'll eat the right sort of things and won't want to just eat out of emotion, we'll eat more when we're hungry. So exercise helps to manage our moods really well. So next time you're feeling a bit anxious, instead of sticking your hand in the cookie jar or heading for the Cadbury's chocolate thing, then you just go for a walk around the house a little bit. The other tip that I've tried is I've hidden the chocolate really high or down in the shed, so you actually need to at least walk down to the shed to get the chocolate before you get there. So there's strategies you can use. The other thing, and this is probably the biggest factor, is that exercise helps to change our internal physiology. And it's the key thing that helps control the way food and sugars get out of our bloodstream and into the muscles. So I want to try and explain this. I'm a bit of a nerd when it comes to physiology and biochemistry. My favourite subject at university was biochemistry of exercise. So I kind of had to learn how all the chemistry that's going on inside the body when we do things. And you know, when I start explaining things to people, I can see their eyes glaze over. So we're trying to work out ways to explain this so it's a bit more understandable and people can relate to a little bit. So I'm going to try and use an analogy of a nightclub. Hence my little mate there at the nightclub with all his female friends, right? So if you can imagine that your muscles are like a nightclub. And the footpath going past the nightclub is your blood vessels. And inside the blood vessels is glucose. Yeah? So you've eaten something, and there's glucose running past the blood vessel, through the blood vessel, on the footpath outside the nightclub. Now, does anyone know what a spruca is? They don't use it much anymore, but a spruca was somebody who'd stand out in front of the nightclub and say, come in here, this is great show, great music. Well, insulin in our bodies is a bit like a spruca. Its job is to get the glucose out of the bloodstream and into the nightclub, off the footpath and into the nightclub. Because when it's out in the bloodstream, if there's too much glucose out there, then it starts to cause some problems. They start drawing graffiti on the walls and things like that. Which is exactly what the glucose does. If there's too much in the bloodstream, it kind of sticks to the walls of the arteries and causes problems. So I want you to imagine that this glucose has got inside the muscle, and it's out there on the dance floor. Now, if you're at a nightclub, you usually stick around at the nightclub until you get worn out, don't you? I mean, you paid your money to get in, they're not cheap to get in, so you stay there until you've had enough. Imagine you're at a nightclub and this is the music that they're playing.
Say, who is this walking man?
Stay there all night, right? So what's going to happen if that's the music in the nightclub? No one's going to leave and there's going to be a crowd out the front because the dance floor's full. Right? When we don't exercise, that's kind of what happens. Like the energy stores inside the muscles kind of just sit there hanging out because they're not getting used up, right? And it kind of banks up inside our blood vessels. And the little spruker out there has got to work really, really hard to try and shove people in, because it's full and he's trying to push them through the door. Yeah? That's kind of what happens with diabetes, and that's what happens when we don't exercise, because we're not burning up anything, because we're just kind of no activity going on, or it's very light activity. Now, what happens then is the spruker will say, listen, why don't you can't fit in here, why don't you go over there to the pub? Now the pub just happens to be a little fat pub. So all the glucose that can't get in the nightclub into the muscles ends up over in the fat pub where the beer and the chips are, and it sticks on here. Okay? Now I want you to imagine that they realise what's going on and they change the music at the nightclub. Some of us will stick around longer, but we're going to get worn out and we're going to go and have some rest, aren't we? Especially if we've got a bunch of grey hair as I have. So people go onto the dance floor, do their bit, and then they need a rest. So there's constant flow of people coming into the nightclub. So all the glucose that's stuck on the footpath can get in because there's room on the dance floor because people are worn out and they've used up all their glucose. That's the main reason that exercise makes such a difference to how we manage our weight over the long term and our long-term health. Is because what we have to do is we need to burn up all that energy, all that good food, 80% of that good food, yeah, because we left the other 20% on the plate. See, I was listening.
Yeah.
So all that good food, we've got to get into the muscles, but if we never exercise at an intensity that's kind of hard enough to burn up that energy, the new energy coming in every time, I've got nowhere to go, so it ends up in the footpath. So over the long term, we've got to keep that constant flow of energy going through. And that's why exercise is such a critical part of how we manage our physiology. So what does it do? Exercise effectively makes room for the energy stores to go. I live in a household with two teenage boys, so I've got a fridge that's always got room. Has anyone ever gone to put something in the fridge you can't find somewhere on the shelf?
Yes.
Yeah. Doesn't happen in my household. Another 5 years when they've gone, maybe it will. But exercise effectively means that there's room to stick more food back into the muscles and into the cells because we've used it up. Yeah. So it's like having teenage boys in your household. They keep emptying out the shelves so you've got room for more food to put in there. We also know that there's some chemical changes and some metabolic changes that happen in the cells when we exercise. And what it effectively does is it effectively opens the door for the energy to get into the cells, out of the bloodstream, without insulin, without that little spruiker guy, having to do much work. So it means our body's working a lot less hard to get energy out of the food that we've eaten, out of the bloodstream, and into the cells. So the reason we've got this epidemic, we keep hearing about, we've got this epidemic about extra body, overweight and diabetes. And effectively all diabetes is when there's not enough room in the cells and the door to the nightclub gets closed off and the insulin has to keep working, so the little sprinkler's got to keep working to try and get more and more of that glucose out of the blood and into the cells. And if it can't get it in, it gets exhausted. And that's really what diabetes is when the little spruiker goes, oh, I've had enough, I'm not doing this anymore. And so the glucose builds up in our blood system and causes some problems. Yeah? But exercise tends to open the door, so insulin doesn't really have to do any work at all. Yeah? And we don't have to keep pumping insulin out into the system to get the glucose out. So it opens the door to let the energy in. There's a couple of kinds of fat in the body. Who's seen the Live Lighter program? You know, with the on TV now, and the grabbable guns talking about the visceral fat. So that's one type of fat in the body. It's white fat, and it's really just an energy it's just a way that we store energy, and it produces some hormones and some chemicals which aren't that good for our health. They change the way our cholesterol works, and they do some other things. But there's another sort of fat in the body, which is a brown fat. Yeah? And it's more to do with maintaining our energy supplies, our body temperature, I mean. And also, it actually burns calories, whereas white fat's just like a storage. Yeah? What exercise tends to do is it actually tends to turn some of the white fat into brown fat. So it's good fat. Yeah? Now, the reason I've got a bear on there is bears rely on this brown fat when they hibernate. So it's a healthy fat. So exercise will help to turn that white fat, that dangerous fat that we see on TV when they show the pictures inside someone's stomach, into the healthy sort of fat, because we still need some fats in our body. And the other thing that exercise does really effectively is it changes our metabolism. It changes our metabolism in a way that we are better at burning fats. So the fitter that somebody is, the more effectively they can burn fat when they're exercising. And even when they're not exercising, their body becomes more efficient at burning fat. So we don't tend to store it so much, we burn it up much more. So the exercise changes some of the chemicals in our muscles. There's some little tiny things in our cells called mitochondria, they're little like little energy powerhouses, and inside there are all the chemical reactions happening. I told you I was a bit of a chemistry nerd, didn't I? Mm-hmm. All the chemical reactions that happen that help to burn fats.
Yep.
And the more of those that we've got, the more fats we can burn. And we burn them when we're moving, but we burn them when we're not. So the beauty of exercise is it helps us to burn fats all the time, not just while we're exercising. We hear all the time now, don't we, how important body fat is. And we've got this obesity epidemic coming, and it's a major thing. And it's certainly an issue. But I want to change the perspective on that a little bit with some of the research that's been done to show you that it's not just about body fat that's the important thing. In fact, it's probably one of the symptoms of what's happening in our society, but it's not necessarily the major problem. I have to warn you, I'm a bit of a scientist, so every talk I do has to have a couple of graphs in it. That just adds some scientific credibility to it. So this is an interesting study that was done a number of years ago, where they looked at levels of cardiorespiratory fitness. So basically how fit people were. They actually got people measured their levels of fitness, and they measured their percent body fat, and they checked those against mortality, all-cause mortality. So how people, what were the causes of death, and how those two factors related to people dying. They followed these people for a long, long time. So what they found was that if people were unfit and of normal weight or they were obese, they had a death rate per 1,000 person years of about 30. So regardless of whether they're, if they were unfit, regardless of whether they were overweight or normal weight, they died at about the same rate. Then they looked at the people who were fit, and they looked at those that were normal weight and those that were obese. Not just a little bit overweight, but they were obese, but physiologically on the inside they were quite fit. And have a look at their scores, they weren't that different. So regardless of whether they were carrying a lot of extra body fat, if they were fit, their risk of dying of any way was about a third of those that were unfit. So what that tells you really is, it's not the body fat that's the problem, it's the physiological inside bit that's going on, how fit you are on the inside, that determines your health. Yeah. Now does that mean, well, I can go out and eat everything inside and put on as much weight as I like? Well, ideally no, because still there's other health conditions still makes life harder to be carrying a lot of extra body weight. But what it tells you is that if you can improve your fitness, regardless of how much body fat you've got, your risk is a lot lower. They also looked at some of the common risk factors. So we know that smoking, high blood pressure, high cholesterol, down here, were the things that are associated with poor health. And then they looked at that and compared them in people who had low levels of fitness, medium levels of fitness, and high levels of fitness. And so here, if we look at somebody who has low levels of fitness and has no risk factors, so their blood pressure's good, don't smoke, and their cholesterol's good, they've got about the same health risk as somebody who's got high levels of fitness, but got high blood pressure, high cholesterol, and maybe smokes. Doesn't make sense really, does it? So effectively what it's showing us is that if you're fit, you can eat what you like, smoke, and have high blood pressure. No, it's not really telling you. It wasn't the aim of the study, but you could conclude that. But what it does show you, is that fitness is actually probably the biggest protective factor you've got. Because some people are just kind of born with naturally high cholesterol. Their body produces it, and they can go on every diet modification thing they like, and their cholesterol is going to stay in the higher range. Some people naturally have slightly higher blood pressure. But we know that if they can stay relatively fit, get their fitness levels up, they're protected even with those things. So what am I trying to, point I'm trying to make there is, the focus really shouldn't be on how much do I weigh, have I got a few extra kilos, it's actually how fit am I. If I can improve my fitness, then the other things aren't as important. They're still, should we ignore them? No, but they're not as important. And I'll let you in on a secret. Usually when you try to improve your fitness, your blood pressure and your cholesterol and your body fat levels all improve anyway. Yeah. But even if they didn't, you'd still be better off. They usually will, most people they will, but even if they didn't. So I see a lot of people who are paranoid about, you know, I'm 10 kilos overweight and I'm really worried about it. And my advice is, if you're fit and you're 10 kilos overweight, you've got nothing to worry about from a health point of view. Just focus on keeping fit. So I want to share with you, there's some myths out there about losing weight and how exercise helps to lose weight and how it helps to control our weight. Does anyone know what the term spot reduction means? Yeah?
Well, so you want to get weight off your tummy or your arms or whatever that
you target that area. That's right, yeah. Listen, I get this all the time. I've got these flabby arms. You know, I've got these flabby arms. If I do that a lot, will the fat come off here? Yeah? And it's typically women that come to me and say, listen, I've got the flabby arms. And my answer is, well, sorry, no. Your body's going to decide where it comes off. So, you know, doing lots of these is not going to get the fat off there. Because anyone ever seen a tennis player with a really, really skinny arm and a really obese other one? Because you can't expect it, wouldn't you?
Yeah.
If spot reduction worked, you'd expect them to have a whole heap of fat on here and not much on their playing arm. But it doesn't work that way. So the body takes it off wherever. So don't think you need to just do a whole heap of sit-ups to try and get it off your tummy. Yeah? It'll help to tone up the muscles underneath, but it's not going to take the fat necessarily off there. My observation is that fat tends to accumulate at the place where you notice it the most. Yes.
Yes.
That's right, isn't it? Yeah. And so whatever your sort of hot spot is that you worry about the most, that's where the fat will accumulate on you. It's God's way of proving that he's in charge. So spot reduction doesn't work. So we need to be focusing on getting overall as fit as we can, not focusing on just the little problem bits. Yeah. Here's another myth that's been doing the rounds as well. I can only exercise at this intensity because if I go faster than that, I'll get outside my fat burning zone and I won't burn fat. Yeah. Has anyone heard this one? Or been at the gym and seen the machines that says, this is your fat burning zone?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. Here's my advice, ignore that completely. It's totally, it was a concept that came up by somebody who didn't understand the physiology, but it sounds really good. It's a bit, and it works really well because it doesn't help you to burn more fat, so you'll keep going back to like the diet programs that keep you going around. So let me explain how that myth appeared. What happens when we exercise is our body's burning fats and it's burning carbohydrates. It's always burning both. Yeah? As the intensity of the exercise increases, right, we'll come a point where we can't burn fats anymore because we have to have oxygen to burn fats. Right. Can't burn fats without oxygen, but we can burn carbohydrates without oxygen. So we'll get to a point where it's a bit harder and we'll start burning more carbohydrates relative to the amount of fat that we're burning. Right. So we're still burning the same amount of fat, we're just burning more carbohydrates relatively. And that theory came up that if you stay in this low intensity zone, you'll burn more fats, but it's a relative thing that changes, not the absolute amount of fat. Am I confused anyone, or does that kind of make sense? Yeah. So you're burning this much fat, and as the intensity goes up, you start burning this much carbohydrate, and then you keep burning this, but the fat will stay like that. Still burning the same amount of fat, just burning more carbohydrate. So the aim is not to exercise at a really slow intensity, so you can proportionately burn more fats. The aim is to burn as many calories as you can. So you want to be exercising at a high enough level that you're burning fat at the maximum level they'll go, and as many carbohydrates as you can, by pushing up. And there's other reasons why you need to be pushing past that fat burning zone that they talk about. So if anyone ever says to you, well, you know, you need to keep it at this level so you burn more fats, then run away from them fast as quick as you can, because they don't know what they're talking about. Here's the other myth. And this is not just about weight loss, this is about exercise in general. We've for a long time been telling people, you've got to find an exercise that you enjoy. And the problem with that is, the exercise that most people enjoy is sitting on the couch watching the football. It's true, isn't it? That's what I enjoy the most. I enjoy more sitting on the couch watching the football, well, depending on who's playing, Wildcats basketball, because they're winning, we'll go with them. But you get, we kind of enjoy those things more than we enjoy exercise. So when I'm talking to people and advising them, I don't say, listen, find an exercise you enjoy. Let's find something that's actually going to work. Yeah. And it's how do we make it as enjoyable as possible? And how do we make it as productive as possible so you keep doing it? Can I ask a question? Who's been paying off their mortgage or, paid off a reasonable amount of their mortgage? Who enjoys paying off their mortgage? We don't, do we? We don't actually enjoy taking $1,000 a month out of our account and giving it to the bank. But we really do enjoy the thought that we own a bit more of our house, or one day we'll own that house. And we need to kind of think about exercise like that. We shouldn't think about, I've got to enjoy it while I'm doing it. Yes, hopefully we'll get some pleasure out of it. But if we focus on how much we're enjoying it while we're doing it, then we probably won't be doing it properly, and we probably won't be doing the right sort of exercise. We kind of got to focus on what's the result at the end. So you know how Glenn talked about changing behaviours. One of the things that I try to do is get people to focus on what is it that's going to make the most difference. And if you focus on how you feel when you've finished, not how it feels while you're doing it, you'll get a lot more benefit from it. So here's the key. Don't find necessarily an exercise that you enjoy, but find something that works. And the other myth that keeps going around is, you've got to keep changing what you do to get any benefit from it. So that's how personal trainers stay in business, because they keep convincing people you've got to keep changing your exercise to get benefit from it. And we're natural creatures of habit. So why don't we tap into that and find things that work and then just keep doing them? We don't have to change it every time. Now, there's a proviso on that. We can't get to the point where the exercise is so easy that it's not a challenge anymore. So the idea is not that we have to keep changing it, but we have to keep pushing ourselves so it's harder each time. So the exercise needs to be such that we are feeling it and it's a little bit uncomfortable. Probably means we're not going to enjoy it as much while we're doing it, but we're going to get more benefit from it, and we'll feel that much better when we finish. So you don't have to keep changing what you're doing, but you do need to keep challenging yourself while you're doing it. So what are the mistakes people make when they start to exercise or when they're thinking about exercise? There's a few common errors that I think happen. One is, they never get started. Because the hardest part about doing anything new is getting started. And the hardest part about starting an exercise program or just trying to incorporate a bit more activity in your life is actually getting started. So the people who never start, it's always hard. So once you've got started, the first time you do something, it's 100% hard. The second time, it's 80% hard. And then it's 60% hard, and then it's kind of like, oh, that wasn't that bad. But if you've never started it, it's always 100% hard. So you've kind of got to get started. The other mistake people make is that they don't exercise hard enough. So I know we tell people, gosh, if you're going so hard that you can't have a conversation, then you're going too hard. Have you heard that advice? Here's my take on that. Most of the time that's true, but some of the time when you're exercising, you actually need to push yourself a little bit, so you're puffing a little bit. So it would actually be a bit difficult to have that conversation. Not for very long, maybe for a couple of minutes, and then you'll ease back again and go for another, get your breath back, and then you might push yourself another couple of minutes. So you need to exercise to a point where it's a little bit hard for little short bursts during your session. Yeah? If it's not a few little short bursts in there, yeah, then you're not taxing your body and you're not changing your physiology. Burn the fats, get the glucose out of the bloodstream into the muscles. One of the other mistakes people make is they do the same thing all the time. Has anyone seen groups of cyclists around Perth lately?
Yeah.
Like, I've been riding in Perth for 25 years, and when I started, there was about three other groups that I knew of. And now, you know, there's thousands of them. And that's fantastic. But one of the downsides of that is that the people who get into cycling, and let's be honest, they're mostly middle-aged men. Yeah. They're what they're called mammals, have you heard?
Yeah.
Middle-aged men in lycra.
Yeah.
So they're mostly middle-aged men. And what happens when middle-aged men get into something like exercise at that age is they get fanatical about it. That's a good thing, but the bad thing is that's all they do. So I know a lot of people who ride bikes, but all they do is ride bikes. Yeah? And they don't do any other exercise. Yeah? And then I know some people who walk, and that's all they do is they walk. Or there's people who run, you know, marathon runners, and all they do is run. Yeah? And your body is really good at adapting to what you do. So you don't have to keep changing what you do, but you need to do a variety of different things. Because the changes I talked about in the physiology, they actually happen in the muscles. So if you're only riding a bike, it's only your leg muscles that are getting good at burning up the fats. You need to do something with your arms as well. So different activities during the week. So you might walk a couple of days a week, or go to the gym a couple of days a week, and you might ride a bike a couple of days a week, and you might swim now and then. Yeah. Fitting those different types of activities is important, but not doing the same thing all the time. One of the other mistakes people make is they do too much exercise. Who's glad that I've said they're doing too much exercise? And you know why they do that? It's because usually because they're not getting results. You know, they start out doing some and then they're not getting results, so I think I'll just do a bit more. It's been like when, back in the 80s, when the fun run craze was going on. When I was living in America, that's when the fun runs were starting to become popular. So people would start out doing some running, and I think, oh, I'll go for 4 or 5 kilometres. And then they'll go to a 5 kilometre fun run, and that was good. And then they'll do a 10 kilometre fun run, and next minute they're doing a half marathon. And they keep thinking that more is better. But the reality is, more isn't necessarily better. Often if you do less, but do it a little bit more intense, we get much more benefit and we don't have to do as much. So doing just more and more is not the answer. It's about working at quality, not quantity. So there's some of the mistakes people make. So what's the key? What do you need to do to really improve your fitness as best you can? And it's all about getting fitter. Here's the two things to focus on. I need to try and get faster. And I need to try and get stronger. They're the two things that are most important for maintaining your fitness. And they're the two things that are going to help you to manage and control weight as you get older. Yeah? So how do you get faster? The method that's shown to be the most effective to help us get fitter and get faster in the shortest period of time is to do what's called interval training. So higher intensity interval training. So effectively what that means is that you might go out for a walk, and within that walk, you throw in a few little short bursts where you go hard and fast. So if you're out for your normal walk, you might get to a corner and you think, okay, I'm gonna go from here to the end of the next block as fast as I can, or thereabouts, maybe not flat out, but you know, 80%. So when you get to the corner, you're puffing, and you're feeling puffed. So you kind of gotta slow down to get your breath back. So you might go for another 3 or 4 blocks, going where it's quite comfortable. Yeah. Then you get to another corner and you go fast as you can to the end of the block. Yeah. If you were to do that 4 or 5 times in a 30-minute session, you'd get much more benefit both from fitness and from burning fats and burning calories than you would if you just went out for an hour walking at a kind of a comfortable pace. Yeah. So it's those short little bursts. If you're not a walker, but say you do ride a bike, well, the hills, every time you get to a hill, you're going to go hard and push yourself up the hill. So you get to the top and you're puffing a bit, cruise down the other side. Those little short bursts make such a difference to improve your fitness and improve the whole way your body metabolizes fats and carbohydrates. Whereas if we just go along at a constant, steady pace, our body never kind of gets challenged to do that. And some real advantages to training that way. Yeah. One of the big ones is you need less time to do it. Yeah. So within half an hour, you can get a much more productive session in there, exercise session in there, than you would if you just went out and walked for 45, 50 minutes. Much more benefit. Sorry?
Taking your dog for a walk.
Here's my tip. If you've got a dog, you've got to pick the right dog. Yeah. Don't be getting one of those little tiny slow ones that slow you down. So if you're going to get a dog, you've got to get a greyhound. On a long leash. It's got to be a dog that likes to go fast for little bits. Yeah. So that's the getting fast bit. If you get the idea, just go out and so next time you're going out for a session, I want at least for some of it, you need to get puffed. You need to be getting to the end of it and get puffed. So that's your takeaway message. Make sure you get puffed at least once. If you're puffing, that means that you've gone past that limit where you can't burn any more fats and you're just burning carbohydrates. That's your indicator. That means the body's going to adapt and it's actually going to change its chemistry a bit so you, next time you can burn a bit more fat. But you've got to get past that limit. If you never get puffed, you never get past that limit. Now the other advantage of you knowing that getting puffed is so important is next time somebody's annoying you, I want you to tell them to get puffed. They won't know you're giving them exercise advice and you're going to feel a whole lot better. Just, it works. Yes. Sorry? Make them move. Yeah, well you could do that too. Yeah, you could do that. Yeah. So that's the fast bit. Now the other piece to the equation for managing our fitness and managing how our body controls our energy stores and body fat is we need to maintain our metabolism as high as we can. And unfortunately from about the age of 25, maybe 30, is we start to lose muscle tissue if we don't use it. Yep. So we've all seen a grandparent or a great-grandparent who were a lot smaller, older than they were, in fact, may start happening to some of us. Yeah? It's because we don't use our muscles, we start to lose them. Yeah? So we need to do a little bit of strength training to maintain our muscle mass, which helps keep our metabolism higher after keep burning the calories. But the reason we don't eat as much as we get older is because we've got less muscle tissue going on, doing its thing, than we did when we're young. So a little bit of strength training makes a big difference. Now it doesn't have to be strength training at a gym. Yeah? Certainly you can do things around the house. Doing some exercises using chairs. So you know one of the best strength training exercises for your legs is when you're at the dinner table, just pretend you're going to sit down and just remove your chair. And then you do that about 10 times. So just before you get there. Now it looks really easy, but you do that 10 or 15 times and your legs will start to feel it, right? Yeah. You can do push-ups, but you don't need to do them on the ground. You can start out doing them up against the wall, or you can do them on a table, and then you can progress onto the floor. Now I take some sessions with, talk to some groups of people in their 80s and 90s, and I challenge them about the push-ups, because some say, oh, I can never do that. And one lady said, I'm gonna try. She emailed me a couple of months later to say she progressed from doing them against the wall, she was now doing push-ups on the floor, on her knees, but she was now doing shit up to 20 a day that she could do. Yeah. So it's surprising how quickly you get stronger just by doing a few and starting out. Yeah, well, you've got to have the chair next to you. But you'd be amazed how much difference it makes having that bit of extra strength. So we tend to lose a lot of muscle tissue in our upper body when we don't use it in a strength training kind of capacity. So getting faster and getting stronger are the two keys to managing your weight long term and managing your health long term. The big advantages, you know, to doing that, so pushing yourself a little bit when you go out and get puffed and doing some strength training so the muscles actually feel like they're doing some work, is it makes if you do that for half an hour a day, it makes the other 23 and a half hours that much easier. So I don't know about you, it's a bit like paying off my mortgage. I was kind of prepared to put up with the pain of paying a bit extra to try and pay my mortgage off quickly, or as quick as I could, because I knew the long-term result would be beneficial. And it's a bit like that with exercise. You kind of got to say, okay, well, for half an hour, I'm going to have to do this, and I'm going to get a bit puffed, and yeah, it's a bit uncomfortable, and I'm going to have to do my exercises and pretend I'm going to sit down and stand up, or my legs are going to feel a bit, ugh. But 10 minutes later, they'll feel good, and you'll feel much better. Yeah? Now, one of the three things that stops people is they think they're going to feel as bad as they do the first time they do it. So the first time you go out and change your exercise and you push yourself a bit harder, it's going to feel, you know, you're going to feel like, oh, that was really hard. The next time will be a bit easier. The next time will be a bit easier. Yeah. So you just kind of get past that. It's a bit uncomfortable. It should be a little bit uncomfortable, but guaranteed, half an hour after you've finished, your body will start to thank you for it. So the key message really is trying to get faster, trying to get stronger, and not focusing on your weight as a measure of success, measure on, am I able to do my walk or my swim or whatever, am I able to do that a bit faster? Are day-to-day things feeling easier? Because if we're focusing on our weight, we'll get the wrong message, that we won't necessarily get the result that we want. So anyway, you guys, this guy?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Yep. So, Jeff Hugel, one of Australia's best swimmers, right? When he retired, thought he would enjoy life, so he took up drinking and eating pizza and night clubbing.
Yep.
So his cholesterol went through the roof. He got depressed, and you know, his health fell apart very quickly. He decided to get back into swimming, and focused on how do I get back to the level of fitness I need to get back to the Olympic Games or that elite level. And you know, within a short period of time, because he was focusing on that, all the things that were issues for him, his weight, his blood pressure, his cholesterol, his mood, his depression, had gone. Yeah. How many of you think he would have got the same result if he'd said, oh listen, maybe I'll just go on a diet and join Journey Craig? Didn't happen, would it? There's no way. But because he set himself a goal to get fitter, all the other things took care of themselves. So if you go away with nothing else today from me, is your focus is about how do I get faster and stronger, how do I get fitter, all my other health issues, will they disappear? No, but they won't be anywhere near as significant, or my weight won't be as significant, and I'll enjoy life that much better. Thank you.